Without it, there will be no knowledge for a better world. To create that knowledge through research, we need money. But how? We need to learn more about turning project ideas into projects that are funded. But where to start? How to choose? That is what we'll talk more about here today. Welcome to the Science Conversations at NTNU. And today, the topic is how to build strong project portfolios. They have both been part of creating successful research groups, and the projects from the research groups have got much funding. So I'm very glad that Marianne Rudhaug and Jon-Inge Hegerberg can be with us today. Welcome, Marianne and Jon-Inge. So, Marianne, let us start with you. Please tell us a bit more about yourself and your research group.
Thank you for inviting me. I'm a political scientist and have a background in science and technology studies. I'm currently a professor at NTNU at the Department of Interdisciplinary Studies and Culture, where I lead the research group on environment, climate, and sustainability. We are a social science research group, mostly focusing on sustainability transitions and how to make society transition to a more low carbon society. Until 2019, the last 10 years before that, I led a research group on a research center, a center for environmentally friendly research, a national research center, and an interdisciplinary one called Transcend. Maybe it's
okay. But I wonder what gets you up in the morning? What sort of the main research question that you're sort of burning to get an answer to?
Well, I think it's how can we transition from the state of affairs today to a more just and sustainable society? That's what's really, that's the big key questions and the challenges that we really need to achieve and to solve.
And for you, what is a strong research portfolio? What's the definition for you?
Well, for me, I think having a strong research portfolio it's a portfolio that is robust, and I think robustness is we can relate that to many different aspects, really. It's about the longevity of the research, so just having a broad research portfolio, but also one that is have some flexibility. And I guess it's having some long-term projects, like we've been engaging a lot of research centers that have a longer funding horizon. I think that's important, and to not be dependent on one research source or one research topic. So, in one way, to have a research portfolio that is adaptable to different kind of circumstances, and that can be transferable to different areas, and so that you can work with different partners and have different collaborations. I think that's important too.
There's a lot of variety in this broadness then, I guess. Okay, thank you. Jon-Inge, tell us a bit about yourself and your research group, or the group that you're a part of.
Yes. Hello, I am Jon-Inge. Yes, I am a professor in the field of color imaging. Okay, I will get a little bit back to that. My field of work is the Color Lab, or the Norwegian Color Visual Computing Laboratory at NTNU. It's a little bit about the the history of myself. I studied electronics and signal processing at NTNU just before it became NTNU, so you can introduce my age from that. And then I started working on color and image processing for my master thesis in Paris as an exchange student, and I continued there doing a PhD. And then I worked for a couple of years in the US in the industry. And then I was kind of headhunted back to Jurich, to my high school near Jurich University College, and to lead the research activity at the Color Lab that was just kind of started at this moment into there. As a part of the printing engineering program, so it's almost related to printing. And at that time, there was like almost no research at all in Europe. High school near it, there was not a research institution, but it had recently decided to become one because there was a plan to become a university. So there was a lot of support for doing research at the time. So I was very lucky to kind of come in there and have a lot of moral support and time and goodwill. Not just very money, so I quickly found out that, for really building something, you need to get external funding, so that kind of concept I didn't really know before. But I discovered Research Council, and, I can talk more maybe later about different projects. Now, 20 years later, we are now in the Color Lab. We are kind of like almost 60 people in the last consulting, small and large, with five professors, the 9th associate professor, permanent researchers, five of them, postdocs, PhD students, etc. And I lead two new projects currently, and I'm not sure I should say this because maybe I'm jinxed, but we kind of aspire to become a center expert. We will get the answer for the first round in a week or so, I should probably not say that. And just a final, just one sentence about what color imaging is, because that's not so easy for everyone to understand. We could say it's the science and technology of color images, including everything from capture and processing and analyzing and representation, communication, reproduction, and very importantly, the perception, quality assessment on how humans relate to the images. And images, I mean, there's all kinds of images from mobile phones to TV to video conferencing systems like we are in now, or computer vision, medical imaging, so more sense. So that's just a brief introduction to the lab.
So I wonder, you've been working with us for a long time, is there a point in time with a research group that you think, like, yes, we've got the perfect project portfolio? We can just lean back and cool it for a while. Or is it like a constant work? What do you think?
So about? It would be retirement, is that what you're saying? Then maybe, yes, I have I'm done. No, not really, because you really have to be honest all the time, because you cannot wait until you have finished the project and then start thinking about it. Okay, maybe we need another project. These things take time, so you need to kind of constantly work on that, on looking for new opportunities for projects and kind of building the portfolio. So now, not really time to rest. What you can do, and what I've been going through in these years, is to say that, well, I don't have to do everything, right? There's when you build a group, this responsibility. It's also distributed, so it's not like only one person that is kind of developing the portfolio of projects. So, in that sense, you can rest up.
Okay, so you're learning on the process. Mariana, how about you? You said, you mentioned about like long term, short term perspective. Is that something that you're continuously planning and thinking about then?
Yes, I think I could say that we are always trying to get variety in what kind of projects we are doing, and this is very much also a collaborative effort, so it's not something that I see as my only role to do by myself, of course, but it's something that we very much collaborate on, building this portfolio, and I've used in my work at least thinking of this as we have two kind of separate but interlinked strategies, where we on the one hand we work on the what I call the front stage or the back stage, or you can call it front office, back office, and to illustrate that you can think about a car, a dealership in a way, where on the front stage everything is neat and clean, and you have your goals that you check off, the deliverables that you do in projects, this kind of maybe more short term, but looks very polished in a way. But on the back, you have the maintenance and all the things that's going on, and you have a whole group of workers and researchers where we really work to develop our research contribution and how to move the research field forward. So, and I think it's for instance difficult to say upfront what's going to be a very successful project or what's going to be a really high quality project, but I think it's the kind of thinking short term, long term, and what kind of collaborations you do and what kind of projects you do, thinking across different projects in line with that helps a lot to develop your research group and what kind of projects you do.
Take us back to the beginning when you were like a young and ambitious researcher. Did you already know this, like to think the long term, short term, or was it just throw yourself onto any funding opportunities of that?
Well, I think when you're a young scholar, you have to be fairly open minded towards what the opportunities that arise, and it's difficult to be too picky in a way because you don't know what kind of projects you will get in the end. I was quite lucky, I think. I got the first two projects that I applied for, I got through the Research Council, but I think what made me get those projects was getting out of my comfort zone and seeking out opportunities in other areas that we have not worked that long in before. So I think that could perhaps be a good strategy to move a little bit away from the core activities of your department or where you're at and seek out new collaborations and be curious about what's going on in other fields or related fields.
Jonny, how about your comfort zone or research comfort zone? Have you been placed in the middle of it all the time, or are you sort of moving towards the boundaries and beyond sometimes?
I think it has evolved a lot, and you sometimes you have to kind of jump on some opportunities that are a bit outside of what you think you should be doing. Sometimes that opens up some really nice doors to new areas. So I think that's important to be open to that. Sometimes, but not always, of course. I mean, if you jump on every opportunity or every question, people ask you to join something and you say yes to everything, that is not good either because you cannot do everything yourself. So kind of knowing when to say yes and when to say no is a good, I think it's an important thing. You know.
But is that sort of a skill that you'll learn along the way? Because I guess it's not that easy to see the red flags of when to say no.
Well, sure, you need to get some experience. I mean, I still have a hard time saying no. I get easily enthusiastic about new ideas, and I have to work on that. So I'm not sure if I learned not so much.
So how about you, Marianne? Are you turning down opportunities now? Or are you you mentioned being picky in the beginning, but how are you on that now?
Yes. Well, I think the research portfolio developed. It's more and more about picking the right project or trying to pick the right project, because you will get a lot of people coming up to you and ask you to be part of projects, which is quite a nice situation, but then it's a lot about saying no and being a bit disciplined in not jumping on every opportunity. So yeah, that's something that comes a little bit with the experience, I guess.
Do you have some criteria, like for when you should say no or yes?
I think it's coming back to what I talked about earlier. I think when we discussed what kind of projects we would like to do, it's a lot about the thinking about the collaborations or do this consortia, for instance. If you look to Horizon 2020 or Horizon Europe, it's a lot about getting the right consortium in place, and then it's a lot about what kind of experiences do you have with these partners, and also thinking what kind of knowledge can this project bring us in the longer run. So it's always this balance in a way of thinking what's our core activities, what are we really trying to achieve, and then how can this project, even though it doesn't seem that maybe we don't have a big role in it, for instance, but and maybe it's not cutting edge what we've been asked to do as a social scientist in this project, it still can add very valid insights that it can seem together with that many other projects, we can use that to develop our research field further on. So I think that's the kind of way we think about these things. But I say we all the time, because it's not, what to stress that. It's the most of the time it's always in conversation with my colleagues, like, should we do this project, or is this something you should do? And it's also looking at the research group, if there are people who have capacity. I think thinking about capacity is also something we do a lot, and we don't have capacity, for instance, to say yes to everything. So, thinking quite a bit strategically about those things, I think is valuable.
So the team thinking is interesting here. You also mentioned teams. How do you build your team, or build a team to match the type of project portfolio that would be useful?
Well, I think there are team building on in the long term and in the short term. Of course, if you start with the short term, then for a given project plan, it's important to, as you may understand, to be realistic about can we actually do it. And then also it comes down to, is there a significant enough budget so that we can hire a postdoc or a PhD student to do the hard work? Because, you know, we who are already there, we don't have any free time, you know, to do anything else. But we can always find time to supervise and help and provide our insights into something. Somebody else has to do the hard work. So then there's like building a team for a project. Then, you know, we need enough money to get the right people hired. Now, building the team over a longer time, then it's kind of interesting to see how we have been able, the CollabLab has been able to grow also in, let's say, permanent staff over the years. And that has been helped by the projects, because we have seen that, well, you know, there are projects coming in, we need permanence, we need, you know, long-term strategy. It cannot just, you know, it cannot just be one professor that, you know, with new PhD students successively. You kind of have to have an overlap, you have to have it to build things. And then we have been allowed to increase in the numbers, have been allowed to hire, you know, postdoc into a permanent position, or, you know, things like that over time. And that is more long-term team building, which is, I would say, usually what I see is that, you know, when you increase in size, it's mostly because of teaching needs. But we have been able to grow because of research activity and our, you know, good research and the continued need for research, we have been able to, you know, get to this high successful research group. So that's, but then it wouldn't have been possible if the management hadn't kind of believed in it and you know, given something extra on top of it. The project funding, because project funding usually goes for the non-permanent positions, right?
But talking of believing in, because there is one thing when a society is not aware of a certain problem area, or the politicians are not interested in it yet, or aware of it yet, or the funders, or the research funders. So when no research programs and no calls specifically target your research area, what do you do, Marianne?
Well, I think that's very seldom a purpose of discipline that what we do and the calls. And so we always have to be a bit inventive and find ways of aligning what you do to what policymakers and others think are valuable in doing. But I think being quite active in reaching out and talking both to funders and industry, public authorities, and being out there with your eyes and ears, and also sometimes you get the opportunity to get some input, it helps a lot. And for us, it has not really been a problem within our area. Of course, energy, climate, environmental issues are not something that's new, and it's not going away either for some time. So, but I think trying to develop competence in the outskirts, of course, in all what you're doing is also important. So looking in the fringes of what you do, that's the way to do it, and then the long-term projects or often allows you to do a bit more, be a bit more flexible on how you focus your own research. And, so that's a very nice mechanism, I think, like the Centers of Excellence and FME Centers. I think it's been really valuable for us to really grow our own core competences in areas that perhaps politicians or funders are not that aware of yet.
So climate doesn't go anywhere, but and images doesn't either. But did people know that in the beginning, you know?
No, I mean, I think this is something that I've felt a lot on. You know, I think, you know, in these 20 years we have built up our, you know, work with COVID. But in parallel, and very big friends in tech building have been building up, you know, the team on information security, right? And information security is like, ask a politician, and you know, is information security important? Everyone will say yes, you know, and that's kind of on the society, on the, you know, on the roadmap for society, we need that, right? Color images, sure, color is nice, images everywhere, you know, but you need research, you know, why do you want to research on that? You know, no one understands that. So we have had a very kind of different ways to approach that, and what, you know, what I have become very fond of are the, let's say, the open arenas for funding. Right, where you can define bottom up, you can define your research agenda, and you don't have to answer, you know, necessarily to a societal problem or something like that. So, in the research council, there's like a big pool, but there was also this program for the research, not for the university colleges, that we got a lot of funding from, and the military actions, the ITM projects. Then we can define the agenda and our skills. And now, sure, yes, we also actually work with societal impact and projects that makes a difference in society too. But it has been very nice to find those places where you can define yourself, your skills, and what you want to do.
So. Marianne, you mentioned some funding opportunities, but how about the European arena? How have you worked towards the project funding there?
Yes, we've been quite successful in the European funding arena, and I think we started mostly out with the ERMOS project, another type of project. And then we have had quite a lot of EU projects. And I think that's about, as most researchers, about creating strong relationships with people that you work well with. And I think keeping an eye to quality in a way, both in how you, what kind of relationships you build with people when you are a researcher going to conferences. And so, yeah, just getting to know people and be a nice person, I think that's actually a part of it. And also, yeah, not thinking that, for instance, we have done this coordination support actions, which some researchers, they kind of, they don't really think this is really research, but these projects have been really valuable to us because that's been a way to actually to shape the research agenda. These projects have been very close contact with the commission, and we have had the opportunity then to almost speak directly to each other, so what kind of projects do we need. And so again, it's the kind of thinking back and forth between being strategic and thinking how to best to do the best out of the opportunities that you get. And I think just doing a very just be very focused on to do what you have promised and be someone that other partners can rely on. I think that's actually been quite a valuable strategy for us because we've become, and many partners, many other as well as engineering, have similar relationships, I think, that we are seen as very reliable and we deliver what we've promised. And you don't have that everywhere. And so that's something that's cherished.
So being showing yourself as a potential valuable partner is important. Network. How do you work with networking in your main life?
Yeah, I would say this is very important, you know, to, because if you're going to build projects, especially, you know, bigger projects, EU projects, you need to be able to pick and the right partners. And then, of course, you know, network building involves things like going to conferences, you know, in your field and presenting your work and meeting people, you know, and exchanging business cards or whatnot over the years. But also challenging now with many types of projects is that you really need to build a project with people that are not, you know, the same as you. You know, they have to have really different roles and coming from different places. Sometimes you can, that can be more challenging because sometimes you have to learn a different language, so to say, in order to find out that you can work together. So, but yes,
that works out important. I will just move down and see if we have questions from the audience, and we have. How do you compensate for not being able to travel and attend conferences? That's important for networking.
Yeah. I think that's a really interesting question. I mean, it's also something that worries me a little bit because I know from, I don't think it would be possible to build the kind of portfolio you have if you haven't been able to travel. So nowadays there's a lot of talk about restricting travel and, of course, working on climate issues. I, of course, really sympathize with that, but there's something to meeting people in person, and I think it's really underrated how important personal relationships are in research, because at least for the career in the, when you are more experienced, you usually have the opportunity to pick and choose who you would like to work with, and you usually pick the ones that you really like working with. And personal relationships, I think, have a quite strong role in that, actually, because we are when you are, at least when you are more experienced, you have an advantage. And as a young person, you, of course, you or a more less experienced researcher, you need to build these relationships over time. And being not very, I think not being very strategic in that way, but just again focusing on doing great stuff. I think that's the most important thing, and being open to other people.
During the pandemic, have you taken some measures? Have you found some tools that work to maintain and create these networks?
I think when you are really already in the loop, it's not difficult at all to maintain the relationship. Like all the projects go more or less at the same pace. We are not falling behind quite a lot, but I think for those newcomers that want to establish something new, it's quite difficult. So it's really, I think the pandemic is reinforcing inequalities. So those who are already privileged, they can manage, but those who do not have the networks already, they suffer from this.
Jonina, do you have any advice or anything that worked for you during this pandemic?
Yes, so in some way I feel the same with you. I mean, I have a very strong, or we have a strong network. I think, yeah, and it's not so hard to maintain that network, you know, because that's there. So has the network developed a lot in this 1.5 year, you know, I don't know how long time maybe. No, probably not, you know, probably it has been relatively stable. And for me, that's kind of okay, you know, I can kind of enjoy not networking so much, you know, I'm not, you know, attending so many conferences and, you know, relaxing a little bit on that. But any, you know, advice for, you know, the good thing, I don't know, with young people tend to be even more fluent in other kinds of communications, you know, online than we are. So maybe they are able to develop their network and be active in a different way. Because I usually think that I need to meet people first, then we can do video conferencing, right? Then we don't need it so much afterwards, but we kind of need to establish the physical relationship with the conferences. Take advantage of your social media skills and continue to build the networks that way. Maybe that's a good, advice for
the other. So if I understand you correctly, you have, if you as a research group already have strong networks, the pandemic hasn't been so sort of devastating, but it will be important for the research group to help the young researchers be included in this network then. Am I correct?
Yeah, I think so. You know, we work with that in the ITN projects because we have networking there, right? We have 50 students in each of the projects throughout Europe, and they are their own network, and they build kind of the network. And we really look forward to being able to bring, you know, this group together. You know, so that's a different kind of network, maybe, because it's within the project, kind of. But I think I would really look forward to be able to get together again physically. Yes.
You're not alone. We've got a question from the audience, and it's back to social media, among other things. I'll read the question here. Related to the topic of making a research stream visible and understood by other researchers is how to make your research visible. Many outlet channels have come up in recent years, Twitter for instance, although not everyone is extroverted enough to use them. Do you have any comments on that? Marianna, what is your experience?
Well, my experience is that these things are evolving all the time, and it's often hard to keep up, at least when you get a bit older. It's also different social media platforms are used differently in different countries quite a lot. So I think now Norway is probably one of the few countries that use Facebook actually for research communication, while most other countries are used to Twitter. And I have never seen impactful sharing your research on Twitter, but I recognize that it's creating a sense of community in a way, and it makes the distance and the possibility to get in contact with people, of course, much easier. Because that also could be a way of kind of leveraging out a bit these inequalities that I think we have had in academia for many, many years, that some people have a lot of resources and are allowed and can and have traveled a lot and have opportunities to meet a lot of people. But of course, these social media makes it a bit more easier and more leveled out who can be seen and who can talk to who. So, yeah, it definitely has this advantages.
Because we need to learn from the young researchers and as the young English as well, perhaps they have the greatest skill, so that will be an asset to the research group. But we have
just a quick comment on that, because I think, you know, and we discussed that a lot with our, you know, young researchers in the new ITN project, because it has a flip side, you know, because I mean they have to be careful with social media, because that is the time, it takes time away, you know. So yes, you should really be active. We try to tell them you should really be active, you should really, you know, be active on social media for to stimulate your research. But then again, you know, it's maybe a good idea to shield yourself off a little bit and focus on your research. And, it's a bit tricky, you know. But I guess that goes to limit to our whole discussion of whether to network or, you know, send emails and do that, you know, build projects, or whether to close the door and, you know, read the book and write the, you know, science paper. And it's a little bit of the same.
I think it's one of the things that I feel we have been quite good at in our group is to don't think about developing research projects or something happening completely separate from all other kinds of activities. So you use the opportunity when you think about building new projects to also have conversations around what the research frontier, where should we be to read up on the literature and make it more like collaborative and conversation about research, but also focus on moving the research further on.
Thank you. I would just bring a little bit of follow-up question from the audience on network. So, Janine, I'll give this one to you. How do you introduce the PhD students to your own network?
Well, you know, I would tend to, you know, if there's a discussion, for instance, let's say if we have a network that's, you know, working towards a proposal or, you know, discussing things like that, I would bring them on, you know, even if sometimes you have to shield the PhD students, they should work on their own project, but they should also be involved in this kind of thing. So I would invite them into to maybe do something like that from time to time, and I think, you know, presenting at conferences and participating in this kind of dialogue is a part of the networking. But I have to think about that. Maybe I should be more creative in sharing my network with my students.
Have you been creative, Madonna?
I don't know, but I at least remember one of the things that didn't work particularly well when I was a PhD student myself, and my professor dragged me around the room in a big conference hall, talking to this is Professor this and this is Professor XYZ. This was, of course, daunting. I think about including PhD students whenever you can, and in a way, of course, don't disrupt completely what they were supposed to do in their thesis work. I think that's one of the ways of including them, giving them opportunities, for instance, like writing book chapters together. I think writing articles together is one of the things where you kind of invite people in. And, well, I don't know if I've been particularly inventive, but I try to have it in my mind at least.
But talking of things that don't work, as you mentioned, your experience there, of all the project funding applications you write, I guess that quite a few of them are rejected. How do you handle that feeling?
Yeah, a very important point to discuss, because you know, and because you learn to not be angry or not to give up or not, you know, there's all kind of things that is not very constructive when you receive a rejection, because you will, I have, you know, and you will receive a lot of rejections for your very excellent ideas that, you know, they just come with stupid, you know, arguments for why that's not a good idea, you know, it's not that, so, you know, it's frustrating. But, you know, take it constructively, put yourself in the reviewer's shoes or minds if you can. How are they read this, you know? If they didn't get the idea, it's not because they're stupid, it's because you didn't present the idea in the good way, you know? So, you know, try again. That's my mantra. For this one ITN project we have now, we applied 5 years in a row. This time, we got it. Very, very great project we have it now. A lot of ups and downs, you know, and through those 5 years, if it was always, you know, improving it a little bit and, you know, getting a better score, that would be logical. But we were, you know, it was going up and down also, so we were clearly improving, you know, the proposal, addressing the weaknesses, and then next year we got a lower score. So that's the most frustrating. But if you don't give up, then you know, you will get it in the end, you know. So, yeah.
Thank you. We are reaching the end here. Marianne, do you have some, like, take-home messages to the audience about how to build a strong research portfolio?
I think it's probably good to think a little bit, try to build a bit like an entrepreneur when you think about building a research portfolio. So it's a lot about thinking about the problem and then talking to other people about what's interesting for them in solving this kind of project. So it's a lot about aligning with different actors and to seek out what are they trying to solve that can fit well with what you're trying to solve. And apart from that, I think, as I said, quality is extremely important, and also to think about it not in a too competitive way, but as a collaborative effort. And that also helps with rejections. Like, it's not a personal defeat if you don't get the project, but yeah, we were in this together, so it's not so personal in a way.
Being in it together, that's good. Jonina, do you have some take-home messages?
Well, I was thinking maybe, you know, we talked earlier about the balance between saying yes or saying no, or taking opportunities or saying no to something. And I think, if in doubt, say yes. Because I think it's when, you know, of course you have to say no sometimes, but it's from the yeses that these new things come that you wouldn't have, you know, been able to do. So if in doubt, say yes. Yeah.
Say yes. Thank you for joining us here today. As always, there is not one answer that fits all. But stay up, have a long term and a short term plan, and don't take no for an answer, and you will get far. Also, keep the conversation going. I hope to see you here again at the next Science Conversations at NTNU webinar. It will be on June 17th, and the topic is how to gain autonomy beyond your PhD. See you there.